Moderating this esteemed panel is none other than our sister, Michelle Alexander. I'm so honored to introduce Michelle. I have to say that I had an unabashed, unapologetic fangirl moment with Michelle. Yesterday when I ran into her at the coffee shop downstairs, complete with a selfie, which I will be posting soon. But you know, and I learned in the short interaction that I had with Michelle that she is compassionate, open, vulnerable, and deeply concerned about where we are and where we're heading. As you all know, Michelle Alexander is a highly acclaimed civil rights lawyer, advocate, legal scholar, and author of The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Color Blindedness. She has taught at a number of universities, including Stanford Law School, where she was an associate professor of law, directed civil rights clinics, and her transformative book, which you can pick up outside if you still have not read it, I'm sure everyone has received rave reviews, has become a New York Times bestseller, and has been featured in national media outlets and won the 2011 NAACP Image Award for Best Nonfiction. With that, please join me in welcoming Michelle Alexander to the stage.
Thank you so much for this incredibly warm welcome. I cannot tell you how glad I am to be here today, of all days. I'm so grateful that Facing Race has created this space for us to grieve, process, plan, and build for the future following the election that occurred on Tuesday. I am looking forward now to what I know will be a deep and meaningful dialogue amongst some incredible people who I've been longing to meet for some time. A deep dialogue about one of the most pressing challenges facing us as a people, as a nation, and around the globe, especially today. How do we build multiracial, multi-ethnic movements in which we center each other's pain and suffering, as well as dreams and hopes for liberation, and the voices and leadership of those who have been pushed to the margins? There could be no better time for this conversation than right here, right now, a few days after a presidential election that has shredded much of what we have all been working for, striving for in our communities. Much has been lost, but not all. Much of what we have created and built together and dreamed together and birthed can never be taken away. Not by any president, not by any Congress, by no Supreme Court. Our love for each other and for this work, our commitment, our vision to birthing a nation, a society, a community in which every life, every voice truly matters, that remains, and it always will. In the words of Grace Lee Boggs, these are times that try our souls. And I could not be more grateful to be here with you all in this time, in this space, in this particular conversation. But before we begin, I'd like for us all to pause for a moment of silence or remembrance for all those that we've lost in the past year, since many of us gathered together the last time. I'm told that this is a tradition at this conference every year to remember those who are no longer with us. And I'm not going to call out their names, though it's important for us to say their names and to remember them. Any list of names would be incomplete, and what is important in this moment is that we remember those we've lost who have meant something to us, whether or not their lives mattered to the rest of the world. May we have a moment of silence now. Well, let me be honest with you and say that I'm emotional today. I'm feeling grief for what's been lost and what will surely come. For the last few days, I've had friends and family members calling me in a rage or in tears over this election. And at first, I felt just numb. I was stunned, and I was stunned that I was stunned. For I have spent the last several years doing nothing but writing and speaking about the depth of our nation's racial divisions, fears, resentments, and anxieties, and about how the election of Barack Obama has lulled us into believing that much greater racial progress has been made than actually occurred, and that a new system of racial and social control has been born again in this country, a system of mass incarceration that has its roots in those very racial divisions, anxieties, and resentments. Anxieties and fears that are fueled in no small part by the cruel realities of global capitalism, as factories have closed down, work has disappeared, and poor and working people of all colors have been pit against one another, viewing themselves as competitors for scarce resources in a zero-sum game, a virtual hunger's game. But today, I'm no longer in shock. I am feeling this moment that we're in. And the question that is weighing on my mind as we begin this conversation is one that the late Vincent Harding, one of Martin Luther King's speechwriters, once asked. Is America possible? This idea of a multiracial, multi-ethnic, egalitarian democracy, a nation in which diversity is supposedly our strength, a nation of equal treatment under the laws and justice for all, is this all even possible? And Vincent Harding, in his powerful essay, answered this question, yes. But he said, essentially, the odds are against us. There is nothing about justice triumphing in the end that is inevitable. The arc of history does not necessarily bend towards justice. In the words of Dr. King, human progress never rolls in on the wheels of inevitability. It comes through the tireless efforts of us, today we're going to talk about what is necessary, absolutely essential, for us to beat the odds. And we've beat them before. During slavery, the odds were long. When we were at the back of the bus, the odds were long. The odds have been long, and yet, still like dust, we rise. If we are ever going to make America what it must become, it will be because we learn how to build multiracial, multi-ethnic movements that place one another at the center. The brilliant, beautiful, black, lesbian, academic, and poet, and radical activist put it best, the master's tools will never dismantle the master's house. And the tools of division and shame and blame and power grabs and games brought us to this place. And we're going to have to find another way, new tools, new ways of building together. The beauty of Black Lives Matter is that it has challenged us all to learn how to put black experience, black suffering, black voices, black dreams, black love, black creativity at the center. And to learn how to do this work of loving each other, championing one another in ways we've been reluctant to do before. Now, I have with us an incredible group of people who will lead us in this discussion about how to do this thing of building multiracial, multi-ethnic, transformative movements. And we're going to focus today on what it means for racial and ethnic groups to center this experience of blackness in their own work. And I want to invite our panelists to the stage. Can you all please come up and take a seat? Yes. I want to introduce Zon Moua. Zon, who is a queer femme woman born and raised in Wisconsin. She's the director of youth organizing at Freedom Inc. She has worked on gender-based violence, queer and youth justice issues since the age of 16. Her most innovative work has been connecting youth to social justice movements through art, music, and dance. Through her work, she hopes to raise the visibility of queer, trans, black, and Southeast Asian leadership and to make social changes within her community. Judith LeBlanc is the director of the Native Organizers Alliance. She provides and facilitates technical support, strategic planning, mentoring, and on-the-ground campaign development to Native groups. She serves as the UN representative for the Indigenous World Association, a non-governmental organization. From 2002 to 2015, she became a nationally recognized organizer and leader in the US peace movement, a central organizer for numerous campaigns and mobilizations, as the national co-chair of the National Coalition, United for Peace and Justice, and a national field director of peace action. Welcome, Judith. And Alicia Garza. Alicia.
You tried this here.
Who may need no introduction. She is the special projects director for the National Domestic Workers Alliance, the nation's leading voice for dignity and fairness for the millions of domestic workers in the United States. She is also the co-creator of Black Lives Matter, an international movement and organizing project focused on combating anti-black state-sanctioned violence. She is an organizer, writer, and freedom dreamer, and lives and works in Oakland. Isa Noyola is a trans Latina activist and national leader in LGBT immigrant rights movement and the director of programs at Transgender Law Center. She works extensively for the release of transgender women from ICE detention and end to all deportations. is a part of the Not One More campaign team and sits on the advisory boards of the TAGA coalition. Oh, a long list here. So much work she has done. She has organized the first ever national trans action, trans anti-violence convening that brought together over 100 activists, mostly trans women of color, to address the epidemic of violence trans communities are facing. She's as passionate about building the leadership of transgender communities, especially TWOC, who experience high levels of discrimination and violence. She's leading programmatic strategies to help build a leadership pipeline through the creation of trainings and leadership gatherings to share advocacy tools and strategies. She believes that a stronger and more vibrant transgender community is possible when we abolish oppressive systems that criminalize all of our communities, especially trans and queer communities of color. And last, but definitely not least, Chris Crass. He is the author of Towards the Other America, Anti-Racist Resources for White People Taking Action for Black Lives Matter. He has been engaged in anti-racist organizing in white communities for 25 years as a founder of the Anti-Racist Movement Building Center, the Catalyst Project, and in helping launch the National White Anti-Racist Network, Showing Up for Racial Justice. He speaks widely on the need for white people to rise up for Black Lives Matter. He lives in Louisville, Kentucky with his partner and two sons. Thank you all for being here. I want to begin with you, Alicia. Many have credited you and others for launching Black Lives Matter movement. And although I'm guessing that nearly everyone in this room is familiar with this movement, perhaps only through what they've seen in the media, but hopefully through direct engagement in advocacy and activism themselves. But as we begin this conversation, I would love for you to just begin a little bit with the origin. How Black Lives Matter came into being. Many people I have found imagine that Black Lives Matter is strictly a movement against police violence, but I know that its vision and goals and activism and work is much, much broader. So could you begin by just sharing with us the origins and the vision, how this movement came to be?
Well, if we were to start with the origins of the Black Freedom Movement, that's a very long story.
Yeah.
And just to be clear, I think it is important to be clear, and from our perspective, that we created a network. Mm-hmm. But this movement has been created by many, many people. Mm-hmm. It was created by people who refused to go home after Mike Brown was killed. It was created by people who refused to allow for Johannes Messerli to walk free after he shot and killed Oscar Grant on a BART platform on New Year's Day. It was built by people who refused to let Renisha McBride go unavenged when she was shot in the face by Ted Wafer. This movement has been co-created by a lot of people. And so what we did was we built a network. We wrote a love letter to Black people after yet another Black person was murdered and their killer was acquitted. We created space on social media for people to connect with each other, but also to do more than just like and share and retweet, because that doesn't change conditions, right? What changes conditions is when people get together offline and take action in their communities. And then I think the other thing that we have done is created space for Black folks to have political space where we could have a radical imagination. Mm-hmm. And if there's anything that we need right now, it is an increase in our radical imagination. Mm-hmm. I like the fact that we are now all thinking about how do we be creative in the onslaught of what is literally fascism. Right. literally. And in order for us to be successful, we do have to think much bigger than we've ever thought before. We have to be much more courageous than we've ever thought before. But we also have to resist the urge, I think, to absorb ourselves into this fascist movement, right? So what I mean by that is, I think that something that happens, and it's happened with Black Lives Matter a bunch, is that there's some folks that are like, well, let's just figure out how to talk to white people better or differently, mm-hmm. right? And the thing is, no, that doesn't work. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work. So I think we have to be really mindful about how do we keep our imagination unlocked and unfettered. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about this movement, we talk about Black Lives Matter and the origin story of the network, which I think did help to catalyze people taking action in many, many different places. Mm-hmm. We were very clear that it was not just about police brutality, that it wasn't just about police violence, that state violence has many, many forms, including violence against trans women, including the violence of not having the basic things that you need to survive and live in dignity. State violence including the deliberate exclusion of resources and access to the things that you need, right? Mm-hmm. And that when you pursue those things, right, you can be put in jail, mm-hmm. right? Or your murder can be excused, yeah? So Black Lives Matter, I think, is important because we have an opportunity to continue to build a movement that is truly intersectional. Mm-hmm. That broadens our perceptions of who and what is black, mm-hmm. And that allows us to claim space for all of us, mm-hmm. meaning if we can, as black people have over and over again, unlocked the humanity of this country. We have continuously been called to save this nation, but this nation continues to do not much for us. And so, the kind of movement that's possible right now, I think, is a movement that essentially creates room for more people, creates space for more people to be a part of it, to be seen, to live with dignity, and to be connected. Mm-hmm. So that's where I feel like we are, and that's part of the origin story of Black Lives Matter, the network. And everybody here can talk about the origin stories of this movement, because you've all been a part of it.
Yes, yes. One of the things that I really appreciate about the movement is its focus on state-sponsored violence and its insistence upon defining that violence broadly. I have found, you know, in my own work that when people talk about the problem of violence in black communities,
It's limited.
It's a very limited sense of what that violence is. Mm-hmm. And if we expand it to include mass incarceration as a form of violence,
that's right.
Because obviously
that's right.
Putting someone in a cage, mm-hmm. snatching them off the street, locking them in handcuffs, and putting them in a cage would be understood as a form of violence, a violent crime, if a private person did that to another private mm-hmm. person. But when the state does it, then we define it as something else.
That's right.
And we pretend that's not violence.
That's right.
When in fact, we are meeting the problem of violence with violence.
That's right.
Through a state-sponsored
That's right.
form of violence on a very large scale. And so if we're serious about ending violence in our communities, mm-hmm. let's get serious about ending all forms
That's right.
of violence
That's
in
right.
our communities.
That's right.
And you've also, in your movement, been probably the most inclusive in terms of the definition of leadership and what that means and looks like, but also who is speaking, who is leading. And this conversation is about kind of building those multiracial, multi-ethnic movements even outside of what is defined as blackness. Can you say a little bit about why you believe that other racial, ethnic groups need to be willing to center Black experience, Black suffering, and Black struggle in order for us ever to build towards a vision in which all of our lives truly matter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right? Where are the All Lives Matter people now? So yeah, I can't speak on that. So there's a simple answer and then there's a complicated explanation. Mm-hmm. And the simple answer is that our fates are intertwined. And if there's anything that this political moment should teach us, right, it's that we're all going down. And I say that, you know, a little bit tongue in cheek, but not really. Yeah. And it's okay because we need a laugh because it's not really funny what's going on right now. So we need that thing. But in a more serious tone, the stories that I'm hearing about people's hijab being pulled off, mm-hmm. or women wearing hijab being punched in the face, mm-hmm. or kids who went to school, if they got there, because mm-hmm. for some kids, they didn't go to school because their parents were undocumented, mm-hmm. they're undocumented, mm-hmm. they're concerned about whether or not, what does it mean? Mm-hmm. What does this decision mean? It feels like the apocalypse in a way. Mm-hmm. But whenever I hear those stories, I'm like, y'all, we have to all be in it together because our fate is shared. So if we can start justifying Klan marching across bridges in North Carolina, if we can start to justify the murders of trans women, if we can start to justify harassment and violence and abuse of people because they're speaking in their native language, people being told, we're gonna deport you soon. Mm-hmm. I mean, when we start to get to that place, we are no longer human. Mm-hmm. And so we have to really, really double down on what deep solidarity in practice looks like. And one thing that I'm worried about in this moment is that we could move back into our habits of working in silos because we're so scared. Like, okay, yeah, I know I need to build multiracial movements, but right now my people are under attack, so that's the thing I gotta deal with. Mm-hmm. As if, right, there aren't a lot of us under attack, and we're stronger if we are not only united, but coordinated.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So if there's ever a moment to move past shallow solidarity models, where we call a representative of another community to speak for that community's experience, mm-hmm. where we ask people to be window dressing for our actions and our rallies and our newsletters or whatever it is, right? If we're not able to move past that, we are not going to win, period, dot. So the importance of building deep relationship, mm-hmm. deep alliance, and deep solidarity cannot be overstated. Yeah. When we talk about the attacks that people are facing right now, and he's not even the president yet. Mm-hmm. When we talk about the attacks that people are facing right now, deep solidarity could look like mutual defense support. You didn't hear me though. Mutual defense support. What deep solidarity could look like right now is joint efforts that link the issues that we face without samifying us. Yes. We are not all attacked in the same way, mm-hmm. but we're all being attacked.
Yes. Yes.
So let's not do that thing where we're like, well, we all bleed red. Yeah, sure. But the ways that I'm getting attacked is very different than the ways that trans women are getting attacked. But if the efforts that we engage in can connect those forms of violence in a way that shows the distinctness, but also how it's connected, we can win. Because it means that the front is broader. It means that more people get to participate in the fight. It means that less people get to be like, well, that's not really my issue. So I do think it's important to build multiracial alliances. I think it's important to build multinational alliances. And I think we have to be really mindful in this moment not to turn the clock back from 10 to 20 years of work that we have been doing to build between our communities.
Yes, thank you. I want to turn to you now. And I'm hoping you can share a little bit about, first, the meaning of this moment for you personally, but also in terms of the communities that you work with and help to represent. But why in this moment is multiracial, multi-ethnic movement building that kind of places Black experience kind of at the center, an essential part of what we do going forward?
So first I want to start, this quote has been in my heart and kind of just in setting the context for what I want to say. By Concha Bukia, an Afro-Latinx songwriter and poet, she said, there is no time for hope. Hope is for people that can wait. Our people cannot wait. Action is needed. And that is a sense of urgency that my community, that Black trans women, that Latina immigrant, undocumented trans women have been working under. That is a sense of urgency that I find when I visit various communities across the country who are doing case management out of their cars, who are fundraising bail bond money to have their sisters released from a detention facility. Mm-hmm. And it's heavy with me because we have, as a community and as a movement, we have believed and internalized various untruths and various lies. One, that we are disconnected. One, that we have to work in silos. That immigrant rights is not trans rights. That trans rights is not racial justice, right? And in thinking about the ways in which we're working and how we're building across differences and movements, we're finding ourselves hitting walls. And also, you know, kind of just settling for crumbs and somewhat being messy and lazy. Because it's reflected in our policy, it's reflected in the ways in which the current sort of administration has set up a silver platter to hand to Donald Trump in some ways. You know, the fact of the matter is that, yes, you know, stock market prices reached, you know, increased and soared, but the fact of the matter is there was already a budget, increased budget for detention facilities by the Obama administration. So I think when we think about multiracial movements, when we think about in particular, I think I want to just ground myself in the work that we're doing with various organizations that I'm a part of, including Ella para Translatinas and Familia, Trans Queer Liberation Movement, and the Not One More, and Mi Gente, and all the folks, and Song, all the amazing folks that I'm working with, is that there is this question, especially in particular with the immigrant rights movement, around what is Latinidad, right? And in thinking about that, a lot of our organizing and strategies and convenings and meetings and atmospheres has been under the idea around forming Latinidad around citizenship. And how that, in thinking about our identities around citizenship and around you know, sort of the state's acknowledgement of what it means to be an immigrant and what it means to be Latinx is highly problematic, because in that ways we've set really limited conversations. We set up the spaces to not be inclusive, to not think of the richness of our culture, to not think about indigenous roots in our history, to think about Afro-Latinx folks in spaces and how they are centered in these spaces and how they are more than ever needed in the immigrant rights movement. And so within the last several years, we've seen various spaces being interrupted by such folks asking and actually demanding to take up space, right? And how now moving forward with where we're at as a movement, where we're at in a political climate, where we're at in the organizing, that is no longer acceptable. Like for folks to have to interrupt spaces, to say, no, you are not seeing me. That is no longer acceptable as leaders, as folks that are moving large communities, large campaigns. We have to really think about who are we centering and what is, and how are we centering those folks intentionally, right? Not at the last minute, not as a scramble, right? And so I think that I've really appreciated, you know, models and the leadership of folks like Song, of folks at Mi Gente, folks at Familia, folks across this country in the immigrant rights movement, LGBT, queer, trans movement, that have really thought about these questions and these dynamics and how they play out on a day-to-day basis, in the, whether it's membership calls, whether it's a fundraiser, or whether it's convening such as these. Because those things are felt, and folks bring these things into their heart, and they leave, go back out into the community and kind of replicate the same things, right? The other thing I just want to say is that for us to remember, in particular for a trans movement, and in thinking about trans liberation and trans justice, right, I immediately ground myself in the mothers of the trans movement in thinking about our freedom fighters and those that risked it all, right? Thinking about Sylvia Rivera, thinking about Felicia Flames at Compton's Cafeteria Riots, thinking about Miss Major, thinking about Marsha P. Johnson. I mean, that in itself, right, let's like, for us to remember what our elders, what our ancestors told us, right, that it's actually, the blueprint is there, the mandate is there, right, from our elders. And so for us to remember that, and again, to really find true meaning, you know, in the work that we're doing, because in a lot of ways, the LGBT rights movement has lost its way. They've seen racial justice as sort of a tack-on item, as a luxury item in the conversation.
Baby.
And so, and it's reflected in our policies, it's reflected in what we're asking for, it's reflected in what we're actually demanding in our messaging and our comms work. And so when we're thinking about centering leadership, when we're thinking about who is really leading this work, we find time and time again trans women of color, Black trans women, Latina immigrant trans women being set aside, being used as messengers, being used as media spokespeople, being used as accessories and spectacles in order to fill a space. You know, and again, that is no longer acceptable moving forward because there is so much at stake. And going back to my original quote, that my community has been living in survival mode and continues to be. So these ways of attack, all of what, you know, Donald Trump has been promising has actually been the conditions that my community has already been facing.
Yes.
The housing displacement, the lack of access to employment, right? You know, when I visit various higher ed institutions to talk to college students, and I've not once found a trans immigrant, a trans woman of color as a part of the student body. And so when we think about the day-to-day lives and the realities, right, how are we really bringing in these stories and really making them truths in our organizing? How is it really being felt by our communities? Because there is a lot at stake moving forward. Just within the last 24 hours, all of our resources already have been maxed out.
Yeah.
Our lawyers at TLC are... the limited resources that we have, Trans Lifeline, within the first 24 hours of Suicide Prevention Hotline, between the first 24 hours of the announcement of Donald Trump's election, they took 92 calls that they answered and talked to people. 92 calls within the first 24 hours. That was only one third of the total incoming calls coming in. So already, our resources are maxed out, and in moving forward and thinking ahead, we really need to really make these the work that we're doing, you know, not just to give the appearance that it is intersectional by having panelists and by having folks up front to represent that, but actually in the day-to-day work. And I think that is what we're seeing. That is where the magic is in the day-to-day work. We are seeing our sisters do this. And I know it is there. And I think that is the only thing that has given me hope is that magic.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. I want to turn to Judith. Judith has just come back from the front lines in Standing Rock. And, you know, with a nation having been born not just out of slavery, but out of genocide.
That's right.
And with so many people wondering today, following Trump's election, about kind of questions of just basic survival, I wonder if you would share a bit about what you see as some of the common threads that run through the movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, organizing and activism in the work at Standing Rock. What are the common threads, but also what are some of the differences? And what can be done for us to more fully center one another's experience in this time?
Well, first I want to say that being at Facing Race is always so heartening. It's one of my favorite conferences. In fact, when you go to Standing Rock, especially in September when there were 7,000 natives there, you walked around the camp and it was like a family reunion combined with a very intensive, you know, strategic discussion constantly around the campfire. That's how I feel about Facing Race. So I got my flu shot. This family reunion should go on full force. I'm ready for hugs and kisses.
No.
I got my flu shot.
No.
So, you know, I think Black Lives Matter changed everything, everything. And I would say that Standing Rock too, following in the wake of Black Lives Matter, following in the wake of the Dreamers, following in the wake of the Fight for 15, following in the wake of Occupy Wall Street.
Yes.
It's a continuum. And we have been learning about how to build social movements that have a lasting impact on not only policies, but the hearts and minds of people. Because you cannot separate system change from changing the hearts and minds of the people. The people. At Standing Rock, it's a magic movement moment. And it's the longest, one of the longest and biggest direct actions ever led by natives and led in a good way, in a way that's rooted in our spiritual beliefs and traditions. And that it is not a fight for us. It's not a fight to save our water. It's a fight to save our water, to protect our water. There are millions of people who live and work along the shore of that river. That's what this fight is about. It's about saving Mother Earth. In this social movement, like in Black Lives Matter, there are many internal struggles and tensions that have to be resolved and can only be resolved within the context of a native approach among natives. For example, the camp, the Oshete Shokon camp, it's the first time in US history that so many tribes have come, over 300 tribes have come together. It's the first time that the Lakota Dakota peoples, the Oshete Shokon tribes, the council, Seven Fires Council, has come together since the Battle of the Little Bighorn. And for us, our people, because of our land base and having half of our people live on a land base, reservations, people remember pain and trauma and victories and happiness going back generations. Yeah. So when you talk about unity in Indian country, we are dealing with a hundreds of years of trauma, hundreds of years of isolation from public discourse. For most people in this country, Indians, we have been excluded from public discourse. What Black Lives Matter movement, the movement for Black Lives, has done for us is to compel an examination of structural racism. What's the history? What is the relationship between genocide and slavery and our conditions today and racist policing? That's what Black Lives Matter did for us. And when in the heat of struggle, it was blurted out, well, all lives matter, it compelled our allies, our white allies, to dig deep about structural racism. Yeah. But it also compelled us in all of the communities of color to think about structural racism and how it plays out in different ways. Yeah. You know, at Standing Rock, 300 tribes, and we've put up the flags of every tribe. Mm-hmm. Well, someone came and hung a Confederate flag mm-hmm. on the fence. So that display of unity and that display of people, native-led people power on the ground shook up the community. And so all of the fear that was promoted by the governor, by having the National Guard surround us, by giving armed guards going with the school buses that passed 10 miles near Oshete, Chacon camp. It stirred up a lot of fear, but it also stirred up a lot of hatred. Mm-hmm. So the one conclusion that we must draw from Standing Rock and Black Lives Matter is that we must address structural racism. Yes. We must do it with humility. We must do it amongst our own communities of color, but we've got to find that common spot, the place where we come together, where we can really debunk, undercut, and destroy the system of racism.
Thank you. And I want to apologize. I've been so taken with what has been shared here. I haven't done the best job of timekeeping. And so we're running out of time. And I want to be able to give both of you a chance to get into this conversation. And so, Zon, can you share with us a bit from kind of South Asian experience and perspective, and what not only has the movement for Black Lives meant mm-hmm. For you personally, and what this moment means for you personally, but how the movement has helped to aid your work and the struggles that you're engaged in your own community.
Yes. Yeah. So I work for an organization called Freedom Inc., as the introduction. And for folks, if you don't know about Freedom Inc., we are a Black and Southeast Asian organization. But we didn't begin that way, right? When we started to do organizing work, it was in the early 2000s, late 90s, and it was a group of Hmong and Khmer kids who were getting pushed out of the school system, and they started to do organizing work around racial profiling and deportation. And so when we began, we started out as the Asian Freedom Project, and then we became an official nonprofit, and we made the decision to change our name to Freedom Inc. instead of keeping to the Asian Freedom Project, because we knew that we couldn't do the work without other folks of color, right? And that as much as our people needed space, other folks needed space to heal and to do organizing work and to build power. So we made the change over to be called Freedom Inc. And we continue to do our work. And as we continue to do our work, and as we continue to meet with Hmong girls, a lot of Black girls in the neighborhood started showing up and said, hey, this is cool. You all have a space. We want a space, can we join? And we're like, yeah, come on in. Mm-hmm. But then what we started to notice is that when we started to talk about the issues that were affecting our community, the issues looked very, very different, even though we were affected by the same systems, right? So the girls can be talking about education, and the Hmong girls can be talking about, I'm always put in ESL, but I can barely speak Hmong at home. And so then the ESL teachers keep talking to me in Hmong, and I don't understand what they're saying. Mm-hmm. And then the Black girls can be talking about, oh, you know, I keep getting put out of class, and I didn't do nothing, right? Mm-hmm. And it was like they couldn't fully understand what was going on, right? And then we can also be talking about patriarchy. And in the Hmong community, that was polygamy, abusive international marriages, right? And then for the Black girls, it looked different. And the girls couldn't fully understand and see. So we said, instead of saying, well, we can't work with you all, we said, we acknowledge the differences, and we said, there needs to be separate spaces, right? And separate spaces in which we can talk about the issues that are affecting us and really heal as a community, right? And then how do we build and how do we strategize in our communities and build the power? So then we made the intentional decision to split the group. And we knew that we, as Hmong women, could not lead the space for Black girls. So we said, you Black girls are gonna lead the space, and we are gonna pour in resources, we're gonna give you training, we're gonna send you to conferences. If there's no funding, we're gonna split our funding, we're gonna fundraise, we're gonna find ways to put money into you and your growth, right? And your leadership development. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So as we were doing that, and in our own groups, as we were healing and building power, right, we also realized that at times we need to bring folks together, right? Yeah. So how we brought folks together was through our freedom schools, and through that, we talked about our shared strategies and how do we work together.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much. And Chris, coming to you to close this out for us. I can't help but ask you in this time with Trump's election and in reflecting on the meaning and significance of the movement for Black Lives to ask, kind of, what is it going to take in the work going forward to do anti-racist work in white communities? What is required? What needs to be done that hasn't been done? I think it's fair to say that simply doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results is not going to get us where we need to go. So what needs to change and happen in the future in terms of anti-racist work in white communities in the months and years to come?
So I think for those of us who are white, for those of us who have been racialized white in the society, for those of us who want to support white people who are engaged in the society, there's a journey. So for myself, after the Rodney King verdict, it became clear from Black folks in my life encouraging me, you need to figure out how to talk to white people. After immigrant rights struggles in California, Latina organizers saying, you need to figure out not only how to talk to white people, but how to organize white people. And so my first response was, I don't want to organize white people, I hate white people. Because those of us who come to consciousness as white people, we learn about the unbelievable violence, the unbelievable structural annihilation of white supremacy, and our participation, our complicity in it. And so it becomes a soul-crushing, heartbreaking, mind-blowing experience of coming to consciousness as a white person about white supremacy, and you begin to hate yourself and hate other white people. But it becomes a journey from hating other white people to then becoming, I want to be a down white person. And so you do not, I want to be a down white person who has a lot of friends of color, who is involved with the right struggles, who's read the right books, and I love all my white people who want to be down, because I don't want my white people to be down with white supremacy. So even if you're a white person who wants to be down and is feeding some ego stuff or your own therapeutic needs, that's fine, because I want white people who are on the journey. Have you ever noticed that a lot of white people who are working for racial justice are also kind of awkward? It's because overwhelmingly the white people in this country who are confident want to make America great again. And so the white people who are confident, who are talking about race, have been raised in a system that teaches white people to talk about race, whether they consciously or unconsciously know it, teaches them the language of white supremacy, teaches them, feeds them the baby milk of white supremacy from birth to understand this world from a white supremacist worldview. So those of us who want to get free, those of us who are white people who want to do anti-racist work, we must move from hating white people, blaming white people, to not wanting just only to be the down white people, but beginning to recognize that we want to free white communities from white supremacy. We want to. Our anger, our rage is not just at white people, but at white supremacy and what it has turned our people into. Descendants of European indentured servants, descendants of working class immigrants who were forming unions, who were fighting for economic justice, turned into white people, turned into soldiers of a white supremacist agenda, turned into workers to make capitalism function, soldiers to build an empire. So those of us who are white who want to do anti-racist work, it's about moving beyond our anger and our fear of white people to beginning to see that we must courageously work in white communities to provide a different kind of leadership, a different kind of leadership so that white people do not grow up only hearing those who speak about race who are white are the racists. Because I grew up as a young person, the most confident white voices I heard talking about race were the racists. The good white people were either silent, didn't know what to say, were awkward, and again, I love my awkward white people. I want my awkward white, because when you're white and you want to try to get free and you want to do the right thing, you're confused, you don't know what to do, the resources aren't around. So those of us who are anti-racist white leaders must provide opportunities and resources for our white communities to be on the right side of history, to not just see the flaws in white people, but the opportunities to bring white people into the struggle for Black Lives Matter, for multiracial movement building. And Black Lives Matter has been an awakening in white communities that we must move.
On that note, on that note, I hope we can free us all from white supremacy. And I'm so grateful for the work of each and every one of you, really shining a light on our path, on our journey, and the way forward. So I want to say thank you to you. I'm told that we're actually not doing the Q&A. And so you all are going to have to rush them and ask them your questions in person. Thank you so much for being here, for your contributions, and for the work that lies ahead. Thank you.